dont le nom est encore à définir. Donc, c'est un moment très important, raison pour laquelle le frère Nicolas m'a prié de vous saluer très chaleureusement. Et nous sommes très heureux de vous entendre nous parler sur les fondements et les diverses manières de vivre la prédication dominicaine. Nous avons déjà eu quelques éléments sur cette diversité cet après-midi. Merci maintenant de nous offrir votre méditation.
Merci, Frère Joseph. Thank you very much, dear brothers and sisters, for being here this afternoon. You are an inspiring sight to behold. Artists, Dominican artists, brothers and sisters coming from all over the world. And of course, our brothers and sisters here in Estonia. Thank you so much for your support and for your presence. I must confess that I feel so insecure this afternoon because I'm the only non-artist here, I suppose. There are also other non-artists. Okay, supporters of artists in this room. The central image of our celebration of the 8th centenary of the birth of Saint Dominic into eternal life is a work of art, the Mascarella table. If I am not mistaken, this is the first painting depicting Saint Dominic after he was canonized as a saint, and you can see the halo on his head. And Dominic is depicted not as a saint alone on a pedestal, but as a saint enjoying table fellowship with his brothers and sisters. This afternoon, I was looking at that marvelous table of our Dominican visual artists, brothers and sisters. And we have shared with you that same table. On the occasion of the centenary, the Holy Father, Pope Francis, gifted the order with a letter entitled Predicator Gratiae, Preacher of Grace. And the letter says, among the titles attributed to Saint Dominic, that of Preacher of Grace stands out for its consonance with a charism. And what is that charism? The grace of preaching, that gift that was given to Dominic and the order. And the mission of the order, which is the preaching of grace. This is supposed to be capital G, grace, and that is God, of the order he founded. And in this year that marks the 800th anniversary of Saint Dominic's death, the Holy Father said, I gladly join the friars' preachers in giving thanks for the spiritual fruitfulness of that charism and mission. Seen in the rich variety of the Dominican family, as it has grown over the centuries. This is very significant because for the very first time, if I am not mistaken, this is the first time that the Holy Father, the Pope, has mentioned the different branches of the Dominican family and all the branches. Contemplative, he says, the contemplative lives and apostolic works of its nuns and religious sisters. Its priestly and lay fraternities, its secular institutes, and its youth movements. So it's complete. And the Holy Father recognized the diversity of the family of Dominic. And then he continues, together with Saint Francis, Dominic understood that the proclamation of the gospel by word and example, verbis et exemplo, entail the building of the entire ecclesial community in fraternal unity and missionary discipleship. The Dominican charism of preaching overflowed early into the establishment of the varied branches of the larger Dominican family, embracing all the states of life in the church. The Holy Father is actually saying that the Dominican family is a microcosm of the church because all the states of life in the church are present in the family. And in this family, as you know, the majority are the Dominican laity. There are only about 5,000 friars, 2,500 contemplative nuns, apostolic sisters, 6,000 to 10,000. I'm not sure about the recent statistics. But the Dominican laity, 127,000 in the world, which is very much like, you know, the statistics, the demographics in the church, because 99.9% of the body of Christ is composed, the church is composed of the laity. And then he says, this charism of preaching took various forms, like the writings of Saint Catherine of Siena. In other words, the writings of the mystics, of the philosophers, of the theologians are forms of preaching. And since this is a gathering of artists, I need to highlight this, the paintings of Blessed Fra Angelico. Very clearly, the Holy Father acknowledged that works of art are forms of preaching, as well as charitable works of St. Rose of Lima, Blessed John Macias, and our newest saint, the newest santa to be canonized, is St. Margaret of the city of Castello. And then the Holy Father says, so too in our own time, it continues to inspire the work of artists, of scholars, teachers, and communicators. Now, what I would like to share with you is this, some genres of preaching of the brothers and sisters. Some, because this is not exhaustive. One of the questions that intrigued me when I was a novice was, how come the founder of the order of preachers has no recorded homily or sermon? Imagine that. That is a family secret that we keep. The founder of the order of preachers has no recorded preaching. There was no Zoom, no Facebook in those days. Okay, but you know, Saint Augustine, who lived centuries ahead of him, we can still read today his homilies, his preachings, his writings. So how come no one recorded Saint Dominic's homily? All we have are three short letters Dominic wrote. One was addressed to the nuns, and two are about converts from the Albigensian heresy. Some say that Dominic is a preacher, not a teacher. He's a preacher, not a writer. But the question remains, how come no one bothered to write even a few notes about Dominic's preaching? Was it because no one listened to him or observe him closely? But Blessed Cecilia paid close attention to Saint Dominic that she was able to accurately describe Dominic in such a manner that one would suspect she had a crush on Dominic. This is the description by Blessed Cecilia. This was Saint Dominic's appearance. He was of middle height and slender figure, of handsome and somewhat ruddy appearance. He was of middle height and slender figure. Okay, his hair and beard of auburn and with lustrous eyes. From out his forehead and between his eyebrows, a radiant light shone, which drew everyone to revere and love him. He was always joyous and cheerful, except when moved to compassion at anyone's sorrows. His hands were beautiful and tapering. His voice was clear, noble, and musical. She described the quality of the voice, but what Dominic said, she did not record. He was never bald, but kept his religious tonsure entire, mingled here and there with a few gray hairs. So why did she describe the face and not take note of what Dominic said? I would like to believe that there must be a good reason for the absence of any recorded preaching of Dominic. Probably, the absence is meant to highlight the theological truth that for Dominic, the order he founded is his only preaching. After all, he called the first convents not as a house for preachers, but holy preaching itself. That is what I am inviting you to consider, brothers and sisters, that we are all the preaching of Dominic in our world today. We are part of the ever-expanding text of the homily or preaching of Dominic. The word text comes from the Latin verb texere, that is, to weave. The text of Dominic's preaching is a weaving together of the life and witness of those who are captivated by his spirit, by his passion for the truth and compassion for humanity. And in our life and ministry, both ordained and lay ministry, we bring our stories and histories to be woven together, texere, in the ongoing preaching of Dominic. I invite you, dear brothers and sisters, to use in today's reflection what David Tracy calls as the analogical or Catholic imagination, a model of theological reflection that was useful in the time of Anselm and our brother Aquinas. In general terms, this mode of theologizing begins with a humble acceptance of the finitude of human knowledge. God transcends our language and knowledge, and so our theological knowledge is always partial and incomplete. But we can have a real and true understanding of God in analogous ways. Thus, when Jesus, the second person of the Trinity, taught us to address God as Abba, he revealed to us the mystery of God as parent. Yet while we know that God's love must be similar to that unconditional love a father and mother would have for their child, God's love is infinitely much more. I believe that preaching is at the service of helping people know, understand, and experience the loving presence of God in our world. Preaching involves the use of the analogical imagination. But what I wish to do is to invite you to use that same imagination and try to see how the order of preachers, the Dominican family, could be the enduring preaching of Dominic for 8 centuries. As we imagine ourselves to be part of Dominic's preaching, I invite you to consider where you are in the text of Dominic's homily. So if we are the text, where are we? Are you right in the middle in big, bold letters? Or are you a boring, insignificant footnote at the bottom of the page? Are you a footnote that nobody reads, but they really should? Because if they did, they would find out something interesting that gives a whole new understanding of the text that sends you in new, insightful directions. Or are you a note on the margins, reflecting on, critiquing the text? Maybe you are at the margin, barely hanging onto the page, yet whose marginal existence marks the boundaries of the text and provides the world in which the text has its existence. And what does this text say? What do you, the text, have to say for yourself? We are the only but enduring preaching of Dominic in our world today. We are all part of the ever-expanding text of Dominic's preaching. The eloquence or lack of it in the preaching of Dominic today depends so much on us. You know, even St. Paul wrote in his letter to the Corinthians, "You yourselves are our letter, written on our hearts, known and read by everyone." You show that you are a letter from Christ, the result of our ministry, written not in ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human hearts. If the order is the text of Dominic's preaching, perhaps we could use analogically three categories for understanding the sacred scriptures, namely, the world behind the text, or the world of the author, the world of the text, or the world in front of the text, and the world in front of the text, or the world of the reader and audience. And if there are biblical scholars here today, forgive me for doing this. First, the world behind the text. In biblical studies, the world behind the text involves, let me bore you with this, historical criticism, redaction criticism, textual criticism, and source criticisms. And there are different methods of determining how the world of the author provides him with a socio-cultural worldview and intellectual resources that shape the writing of the sacred text. Here, the text is regarded as a window. So think of a page of the scriptures as a curtain. And when you read between the lines, it is as though there is a crack through which you can see into the world of the author. So it's a window through which one could see the world that produced the text. Looking at the ruins this morning more or less gave us a sense of that world almost 800 years ago. St. Francis and St. Dominic lived at a time when, very much like the church of today, was in dire need of a new evangelization. Pope Innocent paints a clear picture of the church at the time in a bull dated January 29, 1204. And the Holy Father said, "The pastors who feed themselves first do not provide nourishment for the flock of the Lord. They have no solicitude to strengthen what is weak, to nurse what is sick, to bind up what is bruised, to search for what has strayed. They keep their sword in the scabbard and negligently celebrate the work of God. There is famine in this land. The little ones cry for bread. There is almost no one to break it for them. So that is the world of the text, of the order, the context of Dominic. And then the Pope's letter addressed to the abbots of the Cistercian order indicates a program of preaching for a new evangelization. And I quote Pope Innocent, "We rejoice and give thanks to the giver of all good gifts, considering that in your order, there are a great number of persons filled with unenlightened zeal for God, powerful in work and word, and ready to give to whoever asks it a reason for the faith and the hope in which we abide. They enjoy a good reputation among people at large because in them, the holiness of their lives is in harmony with sound thought. Their teaching penetrates their life so that people can read in their manners what their sermons explain. In order to provide for the hunger of the people of God, for the truth of God's word, the Pope sent men to engage in preaching and teaching. And the Bishop of Dominic assigned this task and his companions when he revived the holy preaching, Sancta Predicatio, in his diocese." That is the world of Dominic. We have studied that when we were novices. But it's good to imagine that is the world behind the text of the preaching of Dominic today. What about the world of the text? The world of the text, or Dominic's preaching. In biblical studies, the world of the text pertains to the world within the text. That is, the literary elements that include genre, word study, philology, grammar, syntax, etc. The Bible is written in different literary forms: Psalms, Proverbs, prophecy, parables, sermons, and epistles. And they are expressed in the thought forms of Hebrew, some Aramaic, and Greek. If the order of preachers is, analogically, the text of Dominic's preaching, we ask ourselves, what are the genres or literary forms of this preaching? The intellectual apostolate of Thomas Aquinas, Albert the Great, the mysticism of Catherine of Siena and Meister Eckhart, the heroic love and compassion of Rosa de Lima, Martin de Porres, and Juan Macias, the passion for justice and peace of Francisco Vitoria and Bartolomé de las Casas, the courageous martyrdom of Peter Martyr and countless martyrs, the quest of Fra Angelico for the divine that is revealed in beauty. These are well-known genres of preaching in our history. Similar forms of preaching have taken root across history and cultures. But I would like now to turn to some forms of preaching, the main theme of my sharing with you this afternoon. More could be added to this, and you are invited to do so, for they are not exhaustive. I must note, however, that these forms of Dominican preaching are not restricted to the ordained brothers, but to all branches of the Dominican family. As we recall, a wise brother has reminded us that we are an order of preachers, not an order of homilists. So what are some of these forms? The first thing that we need to realize is community life is in itself a preaching. Since March 2017, when Brother Bruno called me to be his socius for Asia Pacific, I have accompanied him in canonical visitations. On several occasions, Brother Bruno began the conversation with the brothers with a question: how is the Dominican preaching in this country? In response, a few brothers would describe how liturgical preaching in their parish or shrine attract people, or how many brothers are involved in the teaching and retreat ministries. Brother Bruno would clarify that he meant to inquire not just about the works of the brothers, the ministry, but also the life of the brothers that support such ministry. The master, Brother Bruno, wanted to remind the brothers that in the beginning, the community of preachers were called by Dominic as holy preaching. Our brother Edward Skillebex reminds us that the life of the religious is a basic apostolate in the strict sense. He said, for a Dominican, to live in community is the first apostolate. Do you believe that? Sometimes it can become a very difficult apostolate, you know. But to live in community is an apostolate. Think of it like married life. The union of husband and wife is a sacrament. If it is a sacrament, then it points to the divine. It is a sacred sign. In a similar way, living in community, which is a microcosm of the church, the body of Christ, is in itself a form of preaching. The unanimity of heart and mind of the church remains its most eloquent form of preaching. It is important to keep this in mind, that we are not just together for the mission. Being together is part of our mission to preach Jesus, who calls us to unity. The second form of preaching is evangelization, which is what we think is our main mission, which is also an act of charity. Pope Benedict XVI, in a Lenten message a few days before he resigned the papacy, he said, the greatest work of charity is evangelization. There is no action more beneficial and therefore more charitable towards one's neighbors than to break the bread of the Word of God, to share with them the good news of the gospel, to introduce them to a relationship with God. So preaching the gospel is a work of charity, and charitable works are also forms of preaching, forms of evangelization. Like the spiritual and corporal works of mercy, they are works of charity and therefore of preaching. The brothers and sisters in different parts of the world who take care of street children, tribal minorities, and marginalized people, those who care for the poor and marginalized, either directly or through their collaborators in parishes, schools, clinics, and hospitals, they all proclaim by their deeds the love and mercy of our compassionate God. Assiduous study in preparation for teaching and preaching are works of charity. If a professor does not prepare for his class, the students become uncharitable. When a preacher does not prepare his homily, you know, he is tempting the people to be uncharitable. So assiduous study and preparation for teaching and preaching are works of charity. I have not yet seen much of the global order, but I am glad for having witnessed how people on the margins have become central to the ministry of our brothers and sisters. Evangelization through education. Many of the brothers and sisters serve as faculty members, chaplains, even administrators in many schools and universities all over the world. The civil faculties in some of these universities have students who are required to devote some of their time to community service in accordance with their proper training. For instance, I know of a university where the students of the Conservatory of Music provide free music lessons during the summer break. Architecture and engineering students provide assistance in housing projects. Students of the Faculty of Medicine and Health Allied Sciences participate in community healthcare and medical missions. Here we see how our forms of preaching create ripple effects of preaching love and care for one's neighbors. Our brothers and sisters are also involved in the formation and education of diocesan seminarians and religious men and women in the various schools of theology and seminaries all over the world. They are helping form the future ministers and leaders of the church. And this is the one that really interests you, no? Preaching through different art forms. Like Fra Angelico, talented brothers and preachers preach through painting, theater, music, poetry, sculpture, photography, and the like. We have seen that this afternoon. But what I want to do is to share with you a video clip. It's not a very good video clip, of a concert of a group of friars called Ingo, Domingo, Ingo, 1587. A music band of Dominican brothers, both ordained and unordained, who eloquently preach by their music against extrajudicial killings in the Philippines in their concert some years ago. So please excuse the quality of the video, but I just want to make the point that even this could really be a preaching of justice and peace.
Said you wanna have peace, you wanted peace that would never cease, but you can never have that peace until you learn to listen to the cries of people dying in the streets. Said you wanna be free and put an end to life's misery, but you can never truly free until you learn to speak for perilous voices have been silenced and still. So everybody now wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up from your delusions. Your post-world is an illusion. Killing's never gonna be the solution. Stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up. Fight this confusion.
Sorry. I miss it, but it's okay. That gives you an idea more or less what I wanted to present. That forms of art can actually be a powerful form of preaching, even preaching against, preaching for justice and peace. So at a time when voices of conscience are easily dismissed and labeled as politicking, perhaps music could find another inroad into dulled consciences. When Fra Angelico seemed to doubt whether painting could truly be in accord with his vocation as a Dominican, Lawrence of Ripafrata encouraged him. And I quote, "You will be nonetheless true friars, preachers, if you cultivate your painting, for it is not only by preaching that we persuade people, but also by the arts, especially by music and painting. Many who will turn a deaf ear to preaching will be won by your pictures, which will continue throughout the ages to preach." And that is really very prophetic, because even until now, we know of the preaching of Beato Angelico, but we haven't read anything about Lawrence of Ripafrata. And finally, preaching through martyrdom, witnessing by our faith. And I mentioned this because I initially shared this in Asia Pacific, and in Asia Pacific, there are so many martyrs. Ordained and lay brothers have preached the gospel eloquently when their voices were silenced by martyrdom. And we have many Dominican martyrs in Europe, China, Japan, and Vietnam. One of the martyrs honored by the church, of course, recently is our brother Pierre Claverie. These Dominican martyrs have preached by giving up their lives. Yet to be a martyr is to be a witness. While dying for the faith is a grace that is given to a few, living for the faith is a vocation of all believers, especially those who embrace the charism of preaching the gospel. Even now, we have brothers and sisters who are heroically living for the faith in varying modes of persecution in Iraq, Pakistan, India, China, Myanmar, and so many other places in the world. So that is the world of the text, of the preaching of Dominic in our world. And finally, the world in front of the text. So the world behind the text, the world of the text, and the world in front of the text. This pertains to the world of the reader of the text, the hearer or the audience of our preaching. The people addressed by the text who live in a concrete context, that is the world in front of the text. One of the approaches for the interpretation of a biblical text is the determination of the history of its influence or effect. Our brothers at the Ecole are doing this, the Bible in its traditions. The manner by which a biblical text is received or appropriated forms part of its ongoing hermeneutic understanding. Thus, the unique context to which the text of Dominic's preaching is addressed expands and it reaches its meaning. I would just like to note here some demographic and geographic facts concerning our world, the hearers of the preaching of the brothers and sisters. If we will do a thought experiment about the world's demography, it would be something like this. This is about 10 years old, but more or less the ratios remain. If we shrink the entire Earth's population into a village of precisely 100 people, with all existing human ratios remaining the same, in this village, there would be 60 Asians, 10 Europeans, 9 from Latin America and Caribbean, 5 North Americans, and 16 Africans. In terms of religion, 31 are Christians, 24 Muslims, 15 Hindus, 7 Buddhists, 6 folk religions, 1 other religions, and take note, 16 are unaffiliated to any religion. According to the Pew Research Center, this is the group that is growing very, very fast. The unaffiliated. Of the 31 Christians, 15 are Catholics. I'm not sure how is the ratio now with the pandemic, no? Because we have lost so many people also. Not just because of the virus itself, but because of those who were unable to get medical help because hospitals are busy with the pandemic. That, in a nutshell, is the world in front of the text of Dominican preaching in our world today. The number of people, think about this, the number of people who have not heard about Christ today far exceeds the population of the world during the time of Christ. Today, there are more people who have not heard of Christ because, you know, there are so many unaffiliated, etc. Now, think about this. 31% of the current world population are Christians, half of which are Catholics. If half of this Catholic population attend the Sunday Eucharist and listen to a homily or liturgical preaching, which is a very optimistic estimate, then only 7% of the world's population could be reached by liturgical preaching. Only 7%. And that is a very generous estimate. But definitely, more than 7% can be reached through the other forms of preaching. In 2017, on the eve of the culmination of the Muslim commemoration of Muharram, I was with our brother Pakistanis on the way to the airport in Lahore in Pakistan. We passed by several checkpoints with heavily armed military men. At one checkpoint, our driver told the security personnel that his passengers are Catholic priests. The guard let us pass even without checking who are inside the car. Brother Pascal, the vice provincial at the time, explained to me, a good number of Muslims know that Catholics do a lot of charity work and we cause no problem to the society. That is why they treat us kindly. Obviously, our actions are better heard or seen than our words. Yet even with this vast world in front of the text, we should not forget the immediate world in front of us, in our communities, in our convents. The people who work closely with us are our first hearers. The first hearers of our preaching, those who work with us in offices, in parishes, our co-workers. They are the first ones who know if we do not live in unanimity of heart and mind according to the rule of St. Augustine. They are also the ones who see us praying, eating, and having discussions together. They too are part of the world in front of the text. In conclusion, am I optimistic about the future of Dominican preaching? Honestly, I am not optimistic. Optimism is born out of a careful assessment of future prospects vis-a-vis our own capabilities and resources. When we look at ourselves, we realize that our resources are not sufficient for us to meet the immense challenges of the future. Okay, there are approximately 150,000 members of the Dominican family all over the world. That's big, 150,000. But what is that in a world of 3 billion people. That is why I dare say I am not optimistic. But I am hopeful. Hope is born of the certainty that God will never abandon us, that God is with us in the joyful, sorrowful, luminous, and glorious moments of our life. To embrace the future with hope is to realize with St. Paul, who tells us, we are only the earthenware jars that hold this treasure, to make it clear that such an overwhelming power comes from God and not from us. One of the most beautiful definitions of hope I have ever encountered is the one attributed to St. Catherine of Siena. I heard this in a lecture when I was a formator. I could not really see the exact place where this was taken. At least this is an attribution, so forgive me if I'm wrong. Hope is the radical refusal to put limits to what God can do. When we hope, we refuse in faith and love that there is a limit to what God can do for us and through us. And you, my dear brothers, who are preaching through different forms of art, thank you so much for reaching out to people who are beyond the 70%, the 7% that come to our churches to listen to liturgical preaching. Thank you for your patience and thank you for listening.
Un grand merci, frère Gérard, pour nous avoir encouragés et nous avoir mis aussi devant tous les défis de ce monde et pour toutes les avenues, pour toutes les portes, toutes les fenêtres que vous avez ouvertes. J'ai été particulièrement touché par cette vidéo des Philippines. Je crois que nous oublions la gravité de ce qui se passe actuellement aux Philippines avec la situation politique et le cri et le chant de ce frère. Et je pense nous rapproche toutes les actions de nos frères et sœurs, des laïcs en faveur des questions de justice et paix. Je pense que vous avez des questions, ainsi que les personnes qui nous suivent par Zoom. Donc, la parole est à vous.
Thank you for this presentation and for bringing in some David Tracy's theology with his idea of analogical imagination. It reminded me that in his idea of using analogical imagination, this relies on the idea of making the sources of Christianity classics for the world, so that those classics can be used as a source material for everyone. So this would mean here to make of the figure of Saint Dominic, of his character, a classic. To you, is Saint Dominic already a classic in the life of the church and for the world? How well is he known? What can we do for that?
Thank you, Frère Agustin. Yeah, in my homily during the Dies Natalis celebration in Bologna, I shared a story. When I was a student brother, I attended a gathering of religious information in Manila. And when I introduced proudly, I am a Dominican, one religious, you know, joking said, in jest said, Dominican? Medieval. And in response, I said, no, we are not medieval. We are classical. And a classic is considered to be timeless precisely because it is timely. It has something to say in every present. And that is why it is considered to be a classic. And how is Dominic a classic? Pope Francis, for instance, said that Dominic is an exemplar of his favorite phrase, a missionary disciple. A missionary disciple. And then he quotes the Libellus of Jordan of Saxony. The Holy Father reads the Libellus. he quotes the Libellus saying, you know, Dominic either speaks with God or about God. Speaking with God in prayer, in contemplation, discipleship. Speaking about God in preaching is being a missionary. So we see that. That is the classic figure of Dominic, even in our time today. And it is sad that sometimes people speak about God without ever listening to God. Or sometimes people speak about the church when in fact they have not really heard the church or they have not really listened to the church. And we see the figure of Dominic as providing us an excellent example.
Brother Gerard, a question from Italy. Thank you for your talk. I'm reading the question here. According to the Pew Research Trust, the main factor influencing the future of religion in the world is demographic. It is the fertility rate of women. How many children they are going to have. Not many people change their faith after their youth. Since women with a religious faith tend to have more children than unaffiliated women, Pew predicts that the proportion of believers will increase in the world. The unaffiliated as a proportion of the world population is likely to decrease. I think one of the things that this tells us as a family of preachers is that we need to take care of the faith of young women. These are the ones who are going to bring up the believers of the future. What do you think about it? Do you have any comments about this? I wonder how our Dominican artists would react to this possibility too.
Of course, we need to preach to men and women. No? But there is something there that I wish to point out. The order of preachers is placed under the matronage of three women. Not men, three women. Catherine of Alexandria. The church here was dedicated to the memory of Catherine of Alexandria. The other one is Mary of Magdala, the apostle to the apostles. And of course, Mary of Nazareth, the mother of the Lord. Dominic also started the order of preachers by establishing first, you know, the nuns, the contemplative sisters. And in our life experience, most of us, if I am not mistaken, at least I have spoken with a few people and I asked them, from whom did you learn how to pray? Or how to make the first sign of the cross. And majority of those I have asked would say from my grandmother or from my mother, from women. It is no wonder that the first preacher of the resurrection, you know, was a woman. So that is very important. The faith is really handed on in the domestic church, in the family. That is something that we need to look at, to look into. How we preach to the families. We are a Dominican family. Does it have anything to say about preaching to the domestic church, which is the family? During the time of the pandemic, in some churches, they have rediscovered the importance of the domestic church. The very first Easter Triduum, where people cannot really go to the church, in some places, they provided liturgy, a form of a liturgical celebration to be presided by the parents in the family. So it was a moment to rediscover the importance of the domestic church. But of course, the question is also addressed to the Dominican artists who are here. So you are welcome to answer with me that question. Anyone? Please. Dominic.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I must say, working as I do in a theological college which was founded by Catholic women for Catholic women, and they are now taking on men, they didn't throw me out. It taught me an enormous amount, particularly about assumptions. I mean, the infamous translation, the church consists of men. I mean, we have learnt how damaging that is. I've also become aware, particularly young Catholic women I've been speaking with, and I don't know if this is just my experience or others, that a big problem in the church is the gender imbalance in the congregations. There are often far more women than there are men. There are a lot of young men, maybe the majority of Catholic young men, who are lost to the church. And for women who, you know, and I hugely admire their generosity, they want their careers, they also want to marry and have children and raise their children as Catholic. But that is very, very difficult if the husband is not religious. You know, if he says to the kids, do you want to go to church with mom or play football with me? You know. So I also think, I don't have easy solutions here, but I think there is a lot of work to be done forming young men. And I don't think that's just the work of male Dominicans to do. I think a lot of those men actually need wise women. They need maternal presences as well. But anyway, that was just to throw that into the mix, as it were. Yes, sorry, Sister Maria. Good. I'm really glad you want to. Thank you. Please disagree with me.
No. Well, we are in the same community, in the same institute he just talked about. And as a woman, I would like to say something. we just discussed this topic with a friend here who is sitting in this row about the importance of women's voices in the church. And well, my argument is, well, we have feminist theology, but why there is even have to be a theology which is calling feminist if theology is just theology, right? It shouldn't be or, you know, we shouldn't even think about the concept we are different. And as everybody should be like supporting women, everybody should support men because we support in humanity. And my argument is there is nothing like feminist woman. There is complementary woman movement. So we are complementary to each other and we have to think this concept as normal. So we shouldn't fight for it. And I think this is the stand we should start from, not fight for something. We should just rethink the beginning of human creature, human being, as we were created.
Thank you.
Voilà, merci encore pour votre intervention et nous en restons là pour l'instant. Le prochain rendez-vous, our next moment, 25 past 6 for yeah, and the Vespers at 7.